side. Back is Bork. Shot in, save. Neely scores on the rebound.
Up in front. Tater shot off at the... They score! Zach Parise out of a netball scramble, and the game is tied.
Not up. Bobby Orr. Behind the net to Sanderson. Orr! Bobby Orr! Scores for the Boston Bruins!
Yeah, you can be the greatest, you can be the best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk the guy, go banging on his door.
You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock,
yeah.
You can move a mountain, you can break rocks.
You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you can find yourself.
Standing in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And the world.
You can run the mile. You can walk straight through hell with a smile. You could be the hero. You could get the gold. Breaking all the records they thought never could be broke. Yeah, do it for your people.
My name is John Tolkien, and I'm president of Massachusetts Hockey. I'm happy to invite you, welcome you all here tonight to our awards, event and Hockey Hall of Fame. I think we've got a great program lined up for you tonight. I hope you'll enjoy it. I'm not going to take a lot of your time out of this to welcome you. There are several notables in the audience, but as we go through the evening, everybody will be acknowledged. So with that, I'm going to turn the microphone over to our Executive Director, Kevin Cavanaugh, to introduce our enlisted. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for coming to the 43rd Annual Awards Dinner, and second time we've run the Hall of Fame induction at the same time here in Plymouth at the annual meeting. Last year was a huge success for this event. Looking across the room, it's an even bigger success tonight. What a great group looking out here. Hall of Fame members, hockey people, volunteers, kids, everyone is represented here tonight, and we appreciate everyone coming out. I won't take a lot of time because I want to get right into the program. Our MC tonight is PJ Stock, former NHL player, Hockey Night in Canada broadcaster, Canadian radio guy, and all-around good guy. I could say a lot of things about him as a former PR director for him in Hartford in the minors, but I'd rather let some of the videos do some work here. So most of you might know PJ from this video here.
Oh, Barnaby is involved.
Yeah, he and Stock is
PJ Stock.
It was just a collision, and Barnaby's gloves were ejected. PJ then dropped his, and here he goes. He throws
got
it quick.
That piston-like action.
He's a tough kid. Barnaby had a really strong scrap last night with
Barnaby
Cummins.
Told the linesman to stay away.
He does that all the time. I think he tries to wear the man out. But PJ's tough. PJ's had a good... Well, Barnaby comes back. Both middleweights, huh? About the same size. PJ with a couple there.
PJ says his mom still upset with him, wants him to score some goals and not fight as much.
You can't help but like PJ Stock. He's a good kid, isn't he? Barnaby last night, he's shaking his head. Let us go. These two middleweights are about the eighth round now.
Looks like they're collecting themselves for another flurry. Look at this.
No, wait. She's... Barnaby with a couple of short ones. There go the lefts and the rights, and they still stay on their feet, Sam. Okay, I'm tired. Tell you, PJ's tough, and Barnaby's, he's hanging right in there, isn't he?
I don't know if that last roundhouse landed.
Here, look at this. Oxygen, call the oxygen. Now Barnaby wants to go. I think he feels that PJ may be worn out now. Well, I don't know. Whoa.
The linesman had enough.
Okay, I'm tired.
So, that's how I got to know PJ. He's the PR director in Hartford. That was something he was very good at. But what people don't know, he also scored the first goal in the American Hockey League in Hartford Wolfpack history. So he wasn't just a tough guy, he was a goal scorer. That was his goal that year as well, right, PJ? But as a PR director, something I did my first year with him, we worked on this commercial too with Norelco. So some of you might remember this one.
We asked the Hartford Wolfpack to try the Norelco reflex action for 21 days. There were signs of resistance.
Get that electric out of my face.
Apathy.
I still have the one my mom gave me.
Doubt.
Your mom has a beard?
And equivocation.
Man, this ain't gonna do nothing on my beard.
Then, little by little, they began realizing how the reflex action razor adjusted to the contours of their faces. It gave them an unexpectedly close, smooth shave without the nicks and cuts of a blade.
Kind of like a Zamboni, eh?
They took an interest in the arts.
Wow, a wax museum.
And the theater. Even their fans noticed they were changed men.
Hey, look at you, pretty boys. So soft, so smooth.
The Norelco reflex action. It's guaranteed or your money back. Norelco. Put it to the test.
I'll tell you, someone, I've known BJ quite a while, and he's got an all-around good guy, as most hockey guys are. He does a great job out in the community. He's one of the true good guys of the game. I'm going to leave you with one more video before we bring BJ up, and it's, it shows you quite a different side of BJ. But I'd like you all to pay attention to this one, please.
To my brother Dean. December 11, 2014, the day you were diagnosed with ALS, was one of the few times where I was at a loss for words. Since your diagnosis, I've had a chance to reflect on a lot of things. I've thought about moments in life that come to define you and sometimes set the course of who you are going to be. Sometimes the moments can be subtle, while other times they can be bigger than you ever saw coming. In my recent attempt to find hope and inspiration, I was reminded of these meaningful words. No matter what the moment offers, always recognize where you came from, realize where you are today, and know where you are going to be tomorrow.
That's me.
Our boyhood dreams and backyard rivalries have stuck with me forever. They have helped make me the man I am today. I know nothing has come easily. We've relied on family, and on each other. From Dollard to Victoriaville, and from St. Francis Xavier University through to the NHL. A large part of what I've accomplished is because of you. You were always there when I needed you the most, and now it's my turn to be here for you.
I challenge my ugly brother, Dean Stock.
Accept my brother's ice bucket challenge.
Last summer, it seemed everyone was issuing an ice bucket challenge. You and I were both challenged to do it, and we did our part to help the cause. However, little did we know that just 5 months later, we'd find ourselves in the position in which we are in now. If I promise you one thing, it will be to explore every channel and every avenue in raising funds to fight this disease. As for where we are today, be sure to keep all your dreams alive. You married your high school sweetheart and have been blessed with three beautiful children. That's what matters most. Be inspired to continue making a difference in their lives. Although I'm the older brother, I want you to know I look up to you. You are more than my brother. You are my best friend. A year and a half is what sets us apart in age, but we've always been as close as any brothers could be. Our family home has been built on love, laughter, comfort, and a lifetime of unforgettable moments. I don't know everything about the fight we're facing now, but I know we are facing it together. Our time is more precious than it has ever been. We will battle this as long as we need to. We won't quit. Your proud brother and best friend, PJ.
Dad reports that PJ lost his brother not too long ago to ALS. But when I saw that video, having known PJ for as long as I have and having met Dean before, that tells you a lot about who PJ Stock is. You see him on the ice and you see him playing the tough guy role out there, but that is PJ Stock, and that's what a lot of our hockey players throughout the world are. So that's the type of story that hockey players bring to the table, and on that note, I'm just going to bring PJ right up here right now and introduce him to PJ Stock, our MC for the evening. Of working with Kevin, and actually, those moments you showed are memories, and they're all great memories, and I think that's kind of what today's all about. Kevin, that commercial that you brought up, thank you for it, because I made $30,000 that year in the American Hockey League. I made $22,000 from the commercial alone. So, thank you for that. Sorry, sucker. You showed the title Matthew Barnaby. I had one with Stephen Pete that was one of my favorite career moments, and we're not saying anything about violence in the game of hockey or encouraging it whatsoever, but it was just one of those great moments that is a memory. And on the ice, it was what it was, but in the bar, it was a great night. It was a great night that night. It was spectacular. And my brother Dean, we lost last September. We did everything together right to the end. And we have so many memories. Of my time in Hartford, in New York, where I had the opportunity of playing with Wayne Gretzky. Played for Montreal, so sorry about that. And of course, my time supporting the B. Playing with Joe Court. I know. Teddy's in here somewhere. Ted Donato, wherever he is, well, I know his song somewhere. Ted, through training camp with Ted Donato, who, again, thanks for memories. Ted stole my job. Brian Court, who is here as well, a normal, another one that I built my career path, helped me with memories, and she was a goalie coach and back with the Boston Bruins. You know, for a goalie coach, how frustrating it is when you have a guy trying to shoot under goalie and you always want the top slot, you just can't lift it. And that was my career, pretty much. Frustrating goalie coaches. I have so many great memories. And I think that's what today is going to be all about. Honoring people like yourself that help creating lifelong memories. I have four kids today. One son, three daughters. They all play hockey. I'm a full-time Uber driver right now. When I was a kid, you kind of thought everything just happened. You get to the rink, obviously you get rid of the rink, open up your bag would be full, obviously your stick would be taped, your skates would be sharpened, Zamboni, of course, the ice would be all ready for you. Six skates, everything, jerseys, name tags, everything would be done, hot dog after. Then you have a kid, then you have four. And then you get involved. And then you realize all the needs and asks that are necessary, all the sacrifices that are made by so many people, like the people in this room. Energy, time, money, sanity. One that kicks in a bunch. Everyone making sacrifices that really don't get noticed. Every shift is a memory. Shot. Goal, save, hit, fight, post-wave fight. Memories are created because of people like you. And we're back to the videos. You know, those are all fantastic memories. And the Barnaby one, I wish I could punch a little bit harder because he wouldn't shut up. But other than Matthew, Matthew's did a great job in the NHL for a long time. Really tough guy. Different time, obviously. You can go through that. But wish I could punch a little bit harder, just that one time. But hopefully no one will get hurt. But nonetheless, those videos are memories. And I got to do all of that because of people like you here tonight. Some people later are going to be receiving honors from a guy with some pretty awesome memories growing up
Adam Peewee Bantam Midget Junior. Went with Central Junior in Ontario, Victoria, Quebec, with the same background as King University of East, to pro, to the American Hockey League, to Kevin, to, I know, Jim McGuire was going to talk about there tonight, to the Boston Bruins. Those are all memories that don't take away from me, and they're made because of people like you in this room, not only the ones being honored, but everybody else that does stuff that doesn't get recognized. Unfortunately, until you're a dad or until you're back in that moment, you don't appreciate it enough. Now I am that guy that appreciates it. So on behalf of all the hockey guys, I haven't thanked everyone in this room. I personally thank all of you. Thank you very much. Get through the little thing before. I can tell you a story. Can I tell you a story? Like tell a story again. Okay, tonight's gonna go like this. We're gonna have some entrees. We're gonna do our annual awards. Kevin's gonna come back up after. We're gonna have our dinner, which is surf and turf. Yes, surf and turf. After our post dinner, we're gonna have the Hall of Famers come up and get inducted. And then after that, we're gonna have a little question and answer period going on, which is gonna be a blast. I had an opportunity to speak to some of the guys tonight, and it's man, it's amazing to hear some of the stories how hockey has changed from when I played where it is today to where it was when they played. Stories about having one spare goalie, sitting in the stands. Each team had a goalie and a spare goalie would sit in the stands, and if someone got hurt, he'd go for either team. Oh yeah, how crazy is that? But that's the stuff we're going to get to later. Film of my career. I got one moment that kind of sums up my career in a nutshell. Unfortunately, it was the New York Rangers. But it involves Blake Mulberry, who was a Boston man. So I played the New York Rangers, my first year pro after Hartford, and it's Wayne Gretzky, Pat LaFontaine, Adam Graves, you know. We had Leach, we had Richter, we had Pumperboom, our team was ridiculous. We were the best Edmonton Oilers team. 10 years later, called the New York Rangers. We weren't winning a ton of games, but we still had a chance to make the playoffs. And we had this one game in Long Island where if we won, kind of kept our hopes alive. If we lost that game against our rivals, the New York Islanders, we were done. That was it. That was the game. We get down, about 3 minutes left to go in the game, we're losing 2-0, they score, make it 3-0. Back then, we had Wayne Gretzky on our team. No matter where we went in the rivalry, the buildings were crazy. Well, imagine we can lose this night and the New York Rangers are done. They score, make it 3-0. The building goes crazy. We get ready to go take the face off at center ice, and the ref says, timeout's been called. And now, timeout. Gretzky, who comes back to our bench, looks at our coach, John Butler. John, Mox, everyone has a nickname, by the way. Mox, hey Mox, what's going on? I don't know, what are you talking about? Well, did you call timeout? He's like, no, I didn't call timeout. He looks over at third bench, and Wayne Gretzky, you know, goes over to their bench, and one of us says, it's 3 minutes left to go to hockey, and you're calling a timeout. There was a little bit of swearing involved, but a couple of kids go, make the words, they use. But then he starts yelling at third bench. Two players actually look up at their coach and say, it's not us, it's him. And there's Mike Mulberry, who I love, by the way. I know people don't love Mike Mulberry. He was awesome to me. I love Mike Mulberry. He's just standing there with his arms crossed, kind of taking in the moment like this. It was hilarious. It was actually pretty fun. But Brent comes back to our bench now. He speaks back over, looks up at Muckler, and goes, Muck, they called it. And then now it kicks in Muckler. What? Snaps and starts yelling at their bench. They got to quickly take a quick face off at center ice. And the coaches are going back and forth yelling at each other. Puck gets dropped. It's 3 seconds later. It's the offside right in front of our bench. And the coaches are still going. Finally, Muckler yells out, you really want to play that game? You really want to play that game? Stalker, get your line up. Now, I play on the fourth line. Actually, I always play on the fourth line. But that's the fifth line that night. So Muckler didn't like the fourth line or young kids. I was a young kid on the fourth line. So more or less, after the 8-minute mark of the first period, I was done. So I kind of have ADD, ADHD, everything you can think of. And you guys know you watch the game 20 minutes, you know, it's a period. That's an hour. That's an hour of time. Now I'm sitting on the bench, I'm 22. I'm going nuts. So what do? I make up games. I make up games with the trainers, the back of goalies. I make up games. I got to keep myself busy. Or I haven't played since the 8-minute mark of a game, every game with the Rangers, pretty much. So you're sitting there, and I come up, I spot another Lives one. You play, one of my favorite ones was you play blackjack. So whatever the clock ended on, the last number was your card. So, I got stuff to keep you guys all busy. Like, let me know. You guys have some fun of a game? Sit down with some buddies. And the other thing in turn being the house, because on 16 you have to go higher, right? For $20 a hand, for 2 hours. You know, there's highs and lows and whatever. We're betting on everything. This particular night in Long Island, there's the bench goes like this. There's the door, which I don't understand why they do this. And then there's two seats right here. And Derek Langdon was the other fourth liner with me. Bill Berg played a bunch, so we didn't really count him as a fourth liner. But the two of us are sitting there, and this particular night, I decided to fill my club up with Bazooka Joes. Now, the one thing in the NHL you get abundance of, hockey tape and Bazooka Joes. Back in the day, so I have my entire glove filled with Bazooka Joes. I'm sitting on the left. The glass is right here. The game's been going on. I got lots of seats. And we're betting on, might have had an issue when I think back to me. There's three colors. There's a purple and pink. And purple, pink, and a red. We're betting on which one I picked out next at $20 a pop. So, of course, not 33% chance of winning. So, pick it up, red, you lost, you have 20. Pick it up, pink, you lost, you have 40. Pick it up, I only need 20. But if it was purple, you chew it. You chew the Bazooka Joe because it was awesome, but no, it lasted 20 seconds. Yeah, Bazooka Joe. No one here works for Bazooka Joe, though. Okay, you're both pretty much, it's like, it's cement. So you've all been there. So I've been doing this now for an hour. I can't talk. Anyways, Stalker, get your lineup. What? I got no tape on my shin pads. I haven't moved in 2 hours. You're up. And Ben Langdon is even worse because he unties his skates. He's sitting right beside me. Quickly, speed times the seat. And Bill Berg, of course, to show off and play kill penalties, was kind of sitting down there. They jump off. So the face off's right in front of our bench. And I know there's been yelling going on and stuff, but I've been betting on Bazooka Joe's. And I'm panicking now. I'm trying to get up, find my mouth guard, get my gloves, get my helmet on. Sitting there for 2 hours. Your legs are numb. I jump on the ice. I'm trying to shake my glove. And then I go to take the face off. I'm center. We weren't a top one, but mind you, back then, they put on their number one line with Wojciechowski, Paul Fee, Trevor Linden, they have Jean-Jacques Daigneault, and they have young Zdeno Chara on the point. He was not the Zdeno Chara that you guys all have today, who is a beast. Back then, he was, let's call it Pat. Before he went to Ottawa, started working out, and then came here and just went all world on everybody. So anyways, everyone's swearing. They're swearing going everywhere. And I'm kind of anywhere, but not anywhere, but I don't know what to do. So they drop the puck. It's right in front of their bench. That's the upside down. So I take my stick, and I go to slash Trevor Linden across the chest. Like, he's a red-headed face up like this. I hit him right here. But what happened was, when I went to shake my glove, I couldn't get the Bazooka Joes out of my fingers. So I'm holding out of my stick like this. I got one finger, half of this one, and the other two are curled up. So I go to hit him, and it's like this. And he looks at me like, what are you doing? Not those terms. And I had a big mouth guard for my teeth. And I can't even say anything back. And I look at him, and I take my stick, and I go to him, and he goes like this. It's like a red needle on his chest. And he looks at me. Whatever, he picked off, went back, went to the right defense, Daniel, Chara, dropped it in, goalie stops the puck, and they more or less, they blow a whistle down because I got two wet noodle slashing calls to fight. But now, I ran after Zdeno Chara, so I'm going to fight Zdeno Chara. That Zdeno Chara. not this one that you guys have. And I jump up to him, and I jump up and I elbow him, and I get him right here. I get him lower sternum. And then Claire Langdon, who's actually the tough guy, comes in and jumps over me, like seriously, over me. And he kind of grabs Chara about here. He's the only one that hasn't kind of whacked him. And then there's Difilippo, who's 6'6", who comes skating over. I'm not a great skater. But it took Difilippo a while to get there. Just to let you know how good he's skating. So Duke gets over there and jumps over Langdon to get a hold of his inner child. All these five, everyone fights. If you got some free time later, you got YouTube because it's pretty common. Because I now have this kid, Tchaikovsky. He doesn't fight. I'm not going to fight him. Except for the fight that goes down, starts, my guy gets knocked down. My guy goes to get him. I go to stop it. He starts swinging. Third goalie comes after me. It turns into a chaos. The goalies fight. It was politically correct, awful. It was awesome back then, though. It was okay. Not occurred today, but it was a different time. Anyways, long story short, everyone gets kicked out. Our goalie's challenging their bench, and the old turtlenecks we used to wear, and it just looks awful. But it was a funny moment, and then they're picking up all the gear and getting ready to start. Now the puck's down in our zone for the face-off, and that's where they're going to have to start the game. But the goalie at the far end, where all the charades were going on, he keeps hitting his stick, because now Sal's been kicked out of the game. It's they call the linesman down. And my brother had been kicked around so many times, there was bazooka shows all over the infield. That sums up my career. Memories, man, it's all about memories, and I can remember that one like it was yesterday. So, on that note, again, like I said, it's all of you that you don't know how you're influencing them. Obviously, there's going to be some people tonight that have done an unbelievable job at influencing them, creating paths, giving people a chance, and making memories, not only for the person playing, but for the person watching, for the parent in the stand, for someone selling something at the front door. There's all these memories that are created because of people like you tonight. So, again, thank you all. We're going to be thanking a bunch of great people later, but thank you all for everything you've done. I'm going to let some guys take over now. Let's get this night started. Kevin, come on back up here, and let's get rolling.
So I'm going to call up Kevin Donovan and Dennis Story to present the Milt Kauffman Award. One housekeeping, the stairs are over here. So anybody who comes up here and wants to use the stairs should come over to my right. Thank you, John.
Good evening, everybody. I just want to wish all the award winners that are coming later on tonight congratulations and well-deserved. Tonight, we're here to honor one of the officials from Mass Hockey. And tonight, our Milt Kauffman Award goes to Jimmy Tinirella. Jimmy's been a member of the Mass Hockey Officiating Program since 2005. The key thing about Jimmy, he's shown a passion for officiating. He enjoys teaching, giving back. He's an outgoing personality, which is a key advantage and trait that we need for developing officials. He really connects with the young officials. The young officials are the ones that we're trying to connect with and develop. He has an ease of the way he talks to the officials in coaching them and developing them. He takes a tremendous amount of time from his experience that he brings from working from college hockey, still giving back, and working squirt hockey today. So, as we have changed in Massachusetts with our officiating program, we've changed the way we are developing officials, we're changing the way we run our seminars. We're trying to put more time into developing and giving back. And that has asked our staff to step up and bring more people into the program. Jimmy has taken on a leadership role and taken on teaching one of our ICE sessions, and which is the key development for our officials on where they have to learn and how they develop and put their positioning in. Without Jimmy taking that key leadership role, we would struggle with developing officials. He's taken that advantage. Then he pitches in and teaches in our seminars in the classroom session. So, it's a well-respected award, and tonight I would like to congratulate Jimmy Tinirella for the Milt Kauffman Award. We enjoy what we do, we really do, and giving back is a reward to us. And I'd like to thank all the guys who helped me along the way, Mark Sampson, Kevin, and Mark Rhodes sitting over there. Those guys helped me along the way as I was up as an official, and I appreciate it. And like PJ said, there's memories, and officiating through the years and doing what we do, there's a ton of memories, and it's awesome. I'd like to
thank everybody for that, and thank you very much. Okay, the next award is for Ron and Joe Difilippo, Registrar's Award, and I'd like to call up Ron Difilippo and Steve Calmonchi to get that. In front of a computer while everybody's on the ice and having a good time. And Dave is one of those guys, a stand-up guy, does the job, follows through. In my interactions with him, it's just been great. Dave, well deserved. Thank you very much for what you do. Thank you. Yeah, next award is the Kumpel Special Achievement Award, and Steve Delmonte will give that one out also. We currently do 48 state championship tournaments for the kids at all levels, from the C level kids all the way up to the elite level kids. We used to do about 15 tournaments back when I first started, and we've kept expanding in order to take better care of our constituents, our players. So we keep expanding that, and we need more hosts. And every year we wind up, as we did this afternoon, looking for hosts to host these tournaments. And you get down towards the end, and there's always a couple of tournaments left, and you're begging someone to take them. And Buddy's always one of the ones who's really stepped up. Last year he did 5 tournaments. I think the year before he did 4 of them. So he's always somebody that I can count on when I need those last few tournaments picked up. Buddy, really appreciate everything you do for us, and congratulations, you deserve this award. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'd like to, first of all, thank Dr. Chair for thinking of me for this award. For anybody who was here this morning, I promise this will work very short because I get very nervous, but this is what I made an impact about concussion awareness this morning. Getting a lot of information out to you guys was really important to me. I appreciate being here, and I'm really honored to have this award. Thank you.
USA Hockey has this program called Club Excellence, which is an effort to help local programs become more effective in dealing with their members. And it has all kinds of tools to use to make their lives easier and to get information out to their members. And Tim and Dave came back and said they wanted to do that. So we had dinner last September, we started to talk about it, and they got fully engaged and involved in this. And it ended up with an association seminar that we had about a month and a half or so ago. And I think it's probably one of the best things we've done in a long time. So I wanted to honor them for their energy, their involvement, their dedication to come back here and to do something to help out our members and move our organization forward. So I'd like to bring them up to give them my President's Award.
Seen in a long time. Punch after punch. I tell you, 5'10", 192 pounds versus 6'2", 210 pounds in Stephen Pete. And Ron Wilson, quick to address that shift before by throwing Stephen Pete, his newest tough guy. Oh, the lefts. Pete's got the rights. Pete cut him open underneath the eye. Looks like he'll have a little gash and maybe have to go in for some repairs. But oh boy, did PJ Stock get strong as that went on? Switch hands.
The guys that are going to come up on stage, I'd like to actually acknowledge some people that are Hall of Famers already in the crowd tonight. So stand up and let us give you a quick clap. Great folks, of course. Jack Parker, Stuart. Adam Isher is here. Adam. Ron, keep your boy up. I just saw it. Yeah. I really want to run the call of that. So, not many. Thank you for that. Ron Difilippo. Coach, Ted Donato. Toronto Maple Leafs. Boom!
Hey, Brian.
So as the
the wings, maybe his angles. You know, I'd ask Sergei Samsonov to come out on the ice early and drive the net and off the wing and make sure that he's on his angles. Every once in a while, Byron would have a tough night. So the next day, I'd ask Stalker to come out early and build the confidence. So he really was very helpful to the goalies of the Boston Bruins. Everybody's got to play their role. So I was at my desk this year and I was going through the emails, and for some reason I get a lot of emails from Mass Hockey and all different kinds of stuff, and I get this email about nominations for awards for Mass Hockey Hall of Fame. And I see the email and I go, geez, I wonder when Joe Bertagna was inducted into the Hall of Fame. And I start going down the list. I'm like, wow, Joe Bertagna is not in the Mass Hockey Hall of Fame. It was just shocking to me for everything that he's done. So I took the time and I filled out the form and I nominated Joe for the award. And I kept on getting these emails from Mass Hockey to see that, you know, Joe is going to be inducted tonight. And then the other day I get this email about the elections that are coming up tomorrow. So I send an email over to Kevin Kavanaugh and I say, hey Kevin, I'm getting these emails about the election. Am I voting? Is my position a voting position? He says, no, we're just sending the emails just to keep you in the loop. So this may be an Oscar award tonight, because I don't know if I was allowed to nominate Joe, but hopefully it'll be okay. We won't have to call it back at me.
You're okay.
I'm okay? Okay, so.
We ignored your invited nomination.
Okay, awesome. Okay, perfect. So I'm thrilled to have a chance to introduce Joe Bertagna. Elizabeth said 3 minutes. I'm probably going to go over that because he's got such a long list. I try to condense everything into short bullet points so it wouldn't go too long, but he's done a heck of a lot of stuff. So Joe Bertagna, one of the most influential goalie coaches in North America, began directing the summer goalie schools in 1974, commissioner of Hockey East for 20 years, 6 men's national championships, overseeing national television contracts with CBS Sports, NBC, and ESN, NESN. 6 Ruby Baker Award winners, created and helped oversee Hockey East Frozen Fenway Outdoor Games, fantastic event. Former commissioner of the ECHC for 15 years, executive director of the American Hockey Coaches Association since 1991. Played at Harvard University, leaving the Ivy League with a 2.45 goals against average in 1972. Played professionally for the Milwaukee Admirals. There was a great picture up there, I don't know if you saw it. Played professionally with the Milwaukee Admirals as well as in Italy, leading his team to the town championships in 1975. Goaltending coach of the Boston Bruins from 1985 to 1991 as well as 1994-95 season. Served on the staff of the U.S. men's national team for the 1991 Canada Cup. Served on the staff of the U.S. men's Olympic team at the 1994 Olympic Winter Games. Launched the Harvard University women's hockey program in 1977. The Women's Hockey East Championship Trophy changed its name to the Bertagna Trophy in 2013. Created 7 goaltending DVDs. Here it says, currently resides in Gloucester, Mass. Distinguished, recently received the Distinguished Achievement Award from USA Hockey. I'm sure that knowing Joe, he'd say his Distinguished Achievement Award would be married to Kathy and his kids, Bobby, Joey, and Grace. With all these things, and I could go on for 10 minutes with everything that Joe's done, but with all the accomplishments he's had, that's not why I nominated Joe for Mass Hockey Hall of Fame. The reason why I nominated him was more for Joe's character, his professionalism, and his...
I did that.
It's okay, I can be loud. I can be loud. I don't mind. I can talk without a microphone. I coach enough going across the rink to try to get somebody to attention. But I just wanted to say that for me. So, for me, as a goalie coach, everybody in the goalie coaching profession, they want to go as an amateur. And today, earlier in the meeting, Galloway had a presentation, and he was saying that the U.S. this year, USA Hockey, won 4 out of the 5 world championships.
And what he said was that Mass Hockey and the people in this room should be proud of themselves as a part of that, and it's called the halo effect, right? That Mass Hockey is under the halo of USA Hockey. Well, as a goalie coach in the business and all the other goalie coaches in Massachusetts and everywhere, we're under the halo of the coaches that came a little bit before us. When Joe was coaching with the Brewins, Brewers were one of the few teams that actually had a goalie coach. There were very few goalie coaches that were working professionally, and most of them, if they did have a position, it was part-time. So now it's changed dramatically. I happen to be on the staff of Toronto Maple Leafs. Our goaltending department is 3 guys. We actually have an NHL coach, an NHL coach, an AHL coach, and myself as a goaltending consultant, as a scout, just watching for the trades and draft and so on and so forth. But what's really happened is, for us as coaches, we're all under the halo effect of Joe, and the way that Joe conducted himself, the professionalism, the level of the camps, the level of everything he's done has really helped us. So for me, that was the reason why I nominated Joe, and on behalf of all the goalie coaches that have come after Joe, I want to thank him and introduce him to the Mass Hockey Hall of Fame.
Is talking for when you little Q&A after. Some of you make fun of me, I take the batteries out from underneath you. Just FYI, Brian. I gotcha. We're going to also have some 2017 posthumous inductees. Here's a list of the view right now.
John Garrison grew up learning to play the game of hockey in his hometown of Newton, Massachusetts. He played an unprecedented 6 years of varsity hockey for the country day school before going on to play college hockey for Harvard University. Despite having opportunities to play the professional game, Garrison chose to follow a career in the business world, but that didn't keep him away from the sport. Garrison was a 2-time Olympian, winning silver in 1932 at Lake Placid and bronze in 1936 at Garmisch. In addition, John scored the winning goal in overtime against Canada at the 1933 World Championships, propelling the United States to its first ever World Championship title. Garrison rounded out his international career as head coach of the 1948 United States Olympic men's ice hockey team. In 1973, Garrison was part of the initial class of inductees to the United States Hockey Hall of Fame. Please give a warm round of applause for John Garrison, 2017 inductee to the Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame. Bruce Mather began his hockey career in his hometown of Belmont, Massachusetts, where he quickly became a star for Belmont High School. Known by the nickname Little Poison for his deceptive speed and quick shot, Mather went on to play collegiately at Dartmouth in 1943, where he earned a reputation as one of the Ivy League's greatest players of his generation. A major contributor to Dartmouth's famous 46-game undefeated streak, Mather was the leading scorer with 56 points during the 1947 season, which included a huge win over Michigan at Ann Arbor that year, sparked by Mather's game-winning goal. And although there was no NCAA tournament at the time, Dartmouth claimed the number one ranking in the country that year. In the 1948 Olympics, held in St. Moritz, Switzerland, Mather led the United States in scoring and helped the team place fourth in the games. He was also a member of the 1949 U.S. national team in the World Championships in Stockholm, Sweden. The highlight for Mather in these games came in the contest against Austria, when he tallied an impressive 5 goals in a 9-1 victory. Mather continued his career in the Eastern League with the Boston Olympics, where he was considered one of the best Americans in a predominantly Canadian league. After playing for the Boston Olympics, Mather signed with the Boston Bruins in 1950, and later frequently suited up with the old-time Bruins for benefit games. In later years, Mather coached various youth hockey teams throughout the state. Tragically, Mather passed away suddenly in October of 1975 at the age of 49. Please welcome Bruce Mather, a true friend to the game of hockey, to the 2017 Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame.
Steve Cedar Chart.
Paul asked me to speak quickly and briefly tonight, so I'll try to do both of those things. The reason that he asked me to be part of the introduction, we played together at BC after he came back from Grenoble. Snooks called me in, Snooks Kelly, our coach, he called me in one day and he said, you're going to play with Hurley this year. I said, thank you. He goes, no, you're going to stay back there. Hurley's going to do whatever he wants. I said, yes, coach. So it's an honor to introduce Paul. We call him a shot. He was much more than a shooter. He was a great player. He could pass, he was quick. He was carrying Melrose year after year. With a great team. He was a sensational high school player. I believe, and many people believe, the two best defensemen probably played high school hockey in Massachusetts were Paul Hurley and Milt. And I bet many people believe that, and also many people believe that Paul should be in the same breath as Billy Cleary, Bobby Fattori, and Bobby Kauffman, and that's pretty elite company. Paul was in the era of really the glory days, the heyday of high school hockey. When you go to the rink in the morning at 9, you stay till 9 in the afternoon, 9 in the evening, it's probably on the BC. And Melrose would play the whole town would go to the game. Arlington would play the whole town would go to the game. Walpole would play, it was just the type of era where legends were born. Before junior hockey, which has been a great thing, but legends were born out of this type of situation. And, you know, the legends would grow over the years. Well, Paul Hurley, honestly, was a legend when he was playing high school hockey. People would go and watch him play. One quick story, he comes around behind his net in the Lynn Arena, takes a slap shot right at the goal line extended, puts it in over the goalie's shoulder, Wakefield High goalie's shoulder on the other end of the ice. That's how, one of the many things he did that was legendary. Paul had an unbelievable career at Melrose High. He was named All-Movement defenseman twice. He was an All-American. He was an All-Scholastic. Melrose Hockey had great teams. He was by far the best player on many great teams. He went on to play at BC, and as a freshman, he was the leading scorer. As a sophomore, he was made the best defenseman in the East. His junior year, Coach Kelly put him up front. He needed some spark on offense. He had 32 goals. Then he goes to Grenoble, and in those days, no offense to anybody from the West, it was hard for an Eastern kid to make the Olympic team. Paul made the Olympic team as a junior in college, was the second leading scorer in that Olympics. He came back to BC, was all East, all American, all New England. And the most interesting thing, he got the MVP of a great hockey team that had Timmy Sheehy on it, who was probably the best high school hockey player that ever played in the state of Minnesota. And it was the only time he didn't get the MVP award at BC was
when Paul brought it, Paul made sure that I would say that tonight. he wanted to play pro hockey. I mean, you know, a lot of kids, the goal wasn't pro hockey because it was so difficult to make. He, at the time, was a young person who wanted to play pro hockey. He played 2 years for Oklahoma City, worked very hard to hang in there. He wanted to be a pro. He ended up playing pro hockey for the Hodgson Whalers, and the year that they won the World Hockey Association Cup, Paul was probably the best defenseman on the team. And the real interesting part, he was a great offensive defenseman. But he knew that team needed him to play defense. He became a great defensive defenseman, and he became probably the best shot blocker in the WHA. And he went on to play for Calgary, also in another team in the NHL. He was just a tremendous player who had a tremendous career. I just want to say one quick thing. His brother Leo's here, who Paul wanted to make sure we recognized as his biggest fan. Leo went to thousands of games. Every time Paul played, you see him there. I'd go in the arena to watch a game. Leo would be there at 8 in the morning watching kids. He was probably one of the greatest hockey fans that they would ever had in Boston. And in terms of watching high school hockey, he knew all the players. So in finishing quickly, I want to say the Mass Hockey, I think, has done a great job. I watched what they've been doing. They've done a phenomenal job. And to me, one of the great things they've done is put a guy who unbelievably deserves to be in the Hall of Fame, Paul Hurley.
I love hearing other guys talk about how great other guys were. Because when we're together, we never say anything good about our buddies. But when you're put on a spot like that, that's awesome to hear. That is great stuff. So we're going to talk about a lot of that stuff later on tonight. I'm not going to be half as nice as those guys are. I just love hearing that stuff. I love hearing the way Dan talked about film. It's just, as a younger guy watching some of the older guys play, you don't know what they're kind of like, and you get to hear your friends talk about them. I'm really happy to be here. I'm more fortunate, but positive news, more passionate inductees, ladies and gentlemen, here's on the video.
Like many great Eastern hockey players, Fred Mosley followed the traditional prep school path to the ice game. A Noble and Greenough graduate, where he played 4 years of varsity hockey, Fred moved on to Harvard, where he immediately became a regular on the freshman team. After that, there was never any doubt as to who would be the center iceman for the Crimson over the next 3 years. The Massachusetts-born skater captained the team in 1935 and 36, as the Cambridge Skaters captured their first Ivy League title with a 5-1 record. Overall, the team was 14-4-2. The Ivy League for hockey did not formally start until the 1933-34 season. Named an All-American that year, Mosley added this honor to his capture of the John Tudor Memorial Cup the prior season. The Tudor Cup is given annually to the most valuable member of the Harvard hockey team who displays ability, sportsmanship, leadership, team cooperation, and what John Tudor, class of 29, called the old come-through in the pinch. The trophy was established following the 1929-30 season by members of the Porcelain Club, who were classmates of Tudor, captain of the 1928-29 team. Mosley also competed in football and baseball for Harvard, but it was hockey where he left his mark at the school, being named to Harvard's Hall of Fame for the sport. His fellow United States Hockey Hall of Fame enshrinee John Chase has perhaps summed up Fred Mosley the best. Throughout his hockey career, he was a tremendous team player, a tireless, powerful skater, a great backchecker, and a leader on and off the ice. Please give a warm round of applause for Fred Mosley, member of the Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame class of 2017. The dominating figure of the first 20 years of Harvard hockey was without question Brookline, Mass native Ralph Windsor, class of 1902. The early period of Harvard hockey might well be called the Windsor era. He played in 1901 and captained the 1902 team. Then, he coached with outstanding success from 1902 to 1917, during which time Harvard had 124 wins and only 29 defeats. The teams of 1903, 04, 05, 06, 09, and 19, when he was the assistant coach, were all undefeated. Over these years, he compiled a 25-win and 5-loss record against arch-rival Yale. As might be expected, Windsor developed many stars over that time. Foremost among them was S. Tafford Hicks, class of 1910, and captain of the 1910 team. Windsor was an innovator who took part in the development of the modern hockey stick and screw skates, as well as computing and adopting the official radii for blades, known for years as the Harvard radius. Many new tactics, such as backchecking and the shift of defensemen from the point to cover point to the present pairing positions, are credited to Windsor's genius. In all those years, it's reported that Windsor never took any money for his coaching duties, and his great modesty kept him from appearing in many team pictures. Besides his great contribution at Harvard, Windsor aided hockey at the schoolboy level and at other colleges. He had the distinction of coaching the U.S. Olympic team in 1932 games at Lake Placid, losing only once, 2-1 to Canada in the final game. United States Hockey Hall of Fame enshrinees John Chase, John Garrison, and Ding Palmer were members of that 1932 team. Please give a warm round of applause for 2017 Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame member Ralph Windsor.
Up next, please, we have Dr. Ian Pakowski.
Good evening. Thank you very much for having me here tonight. As a kid who grew up on the North Shore, playing hockey in Beverly, and collegially here in Portland, it's quite an honor to be part of this tonight. Quick congratulations to Pat Kelleher on his new appointment. I played together several Putnam and Boston teams back in the late 80s. It's great to. When I saw his picture, I know this guy. I saw the name, and I think, is this the same guy? Didn't quite look the same, but the red hair was still there. So I've been asked tonight to introduce my coach, my mentor, my colleague, and now my friend, Mr. Paul Vincent, to the Mass Hockey Hall of Fame. When Paul got the call that he was being inducted, he said, oh, I'd like to have you introduce me. And I said, Mr. V, of all the people you've coached over 40 years, why are you asking me? He said, well, you've been there since the first day. But I've known Mr. Vincent for 41 years now. I'm actually 72. I've been around 5 years old. And from then until now, Mr. Vincent has not changed. He's still passionate. He's still focused. He's intense. He still loves hockey. And he loves the players that play hockey. He's coached on championship teams in the NHL, in the NCAA, in two prep schools, in high school hockey here in Massachusetts. He's coached everyone from myself when I was 5 years old and had lots of snots in my nose to Patrick Kane and everybody else. So all these things he's done, he's a lot of guys that coached, a lot of guys won championships. And what makes Mr. Vincent, Mr. V, Vinny, what makes him a Hall of Fame guy? So in 2012, Adam Oates was inducted into the Hockey Hall of Fame, and he said, and I quote, thank you to Paul Vincent, skating coach who took me into his home for 2 years, no questions asked, to help me work on my game. So I was, when Mr. V asked me to do this, I asked people, you know, what do you think about Mr. V? What do you remember? And Mark Adams sent me that video of Adam, and I said, oh my gosh, he did this for Adam Oates, but this is everybody. Everybody Paul came in contact with over 35 to 40 years, this is what Paul did with numerous guys. The lists go on and on. Who he's touched, who he has helped out. So I was able to, with this idea, I reached out to a whole bunch of people. There's NHL GMs, former NHL players, college coaches, even guys like me, just played hockey as long as they could. And asked, what do you remember about Mr. V during your time? And I got a whole bunch of responses. Some people who were pretty influential actually saved their emails in case I ever did a favor. And the common theme was Paul from players. It was like, Paul believed in me. When people didn't believe in me, Paul believed in me. From guys who worked for Mr. Vincent at his camps, there was always the idea that you worked hard on the ice, you had fun, you shot pucks, you worked hard all the time. But it was people, guys, more remembered about the off-ice stuff. It was always clean the locker room up. We learned how to use a mop. I learned how to open up facilities working with Mr. Vincent. Guys remember, always worked hard. Guys who are now CEOs of corporations and friends that I still stay in contact with, always remember the stuff that Paul taught you off the ice. More than on the ice, because that all ends, but the values, the core values that he taught us, we continue to use today. A great quote from one of the Blackhawks coaches who was coached with Paul during the 2011 Stanley Cup run. He said, Paul's magic wasn't that he taught guys how to skate. In many instances, he just convinced them that they could skate. He gave guys confidence that they could use the skills that they had to be more than what they were told they were. So many guys today have continued to learn that from Mr. Vincent and continue that. And that was one of the great quotes from one of the guys from the Blackhawks. In his championships, his four championships, what made Mr. V special to those teams was that he made third line guys play like second line guys. He made fourth line guys play like third line guys. I promise all of you. He made everybody better. He made people better for those championship runs that guys could continue and play better and rise to the occasion. If I could put together what I thought, what I've learned over 40 years of knowing Mr. Vincent and what I appreciate about him most, it would be that he taught us to respect everybody, expect the most out of those that have been given the most, and help those that need the most. So one quick story. I was dead for 40, I'm not that old, but I've been around this to be for 40 years. The first class where I was at the old Beverly Ice Arena, which was now long defunct, I believe. But we were there, and it was four of us, a guy named Jeff Campersall, who ended up being a captain at Princeton, Jeff Blazer, who ended up being captain at Yale, myself, and a kid named Johnny Boudreau, who ended up a good career at Babson. We were there for Mr. Vincent's first class. And he was still a police officer at this point in Beverly, Massachusetts, 1976 or 75. This is a long time ago. But the thing was, it wasn't just Mr. Vincent. We were actually going on the ice as part of the North Shore Skating Club, which was about 100, from my mind and from my buddy's recollection, there's about 100 people on the ice. We're the only ones in hockey skates. We're in full gear, in the whole nine yards. None of us wanted to go on the ice. It was all figure skaters. We're not going on the ice. And I remember yelling at my parents, I'm yelling, I'm not going on the ice. They said, just go find Mr. Vincent, you'll be fine. And all the kids, we didn't know each other, but they all the parents did the same thing. So we go on the ice and find the head instructor, this a woman, I have no clue who she was. But we all said, we're looking for Mr. Vincent. She wanted none of it. She said, you get in the line, we're going to do some warm-up drills, and then we'll figure out where you're going to go. So we get in the line, we go to the first full ice skate, and they're doing toe kick pushes with the figure skates. So I'm first in line, and I start to skate. She says, no, stop, toe. So I don't have toe kick. So I'm trying to do it. So we're down the ice. Jeff, the buddy behind me, goes, he does it. And we're like, we're laughing, but we're little kids just trying to make it work. This little guy, Johnny Boudreau, who was last in line, wanted none of this. So we all get down to the end, and he starts skating as fast as he can. And he's not listening. He's just going. The only thing was he couldn't stop that well. So I'll never forget this. He took out about 20 kids. And the lead instructor wanted none of this. She says, okay, fine. Go see Mr. Vincent. She said, go to the corner. She said, solve the corner. And then from there, that was the first class. It was in the corner of the rink. It was like the original ADM model, right? We had like a little two feet to work, but we had so much done. And from there, here we are, 45 years now. Congratulations, Mr. V. I love you. Very proud.
2017 Boston's inductees.
Ray Chason played for the legendary Boston College coach John Snooks Kelly, who described Chason as one of the very finest hockey players he had ever seen during his 36 years of college coaching. The Cambridge, Massachusetts native led the East in scoring in both 1940 with 67 points and in 1941 with 59 points. Ray is the all-time Eagles leader in average goals per game per season with 2.07, and his 126 points ranks him among Eagles' all-time career point leaders, despite the fact that each of the players listed above him played more than twice as many games as the 32 Ray played during his career. His 8 hat tricks are still a Boston College record. Ray's 2 seasons at Boston College were cut short by World War II. After World War II service with the United States Navy, he later played senior amateur hockey with the Los Angeles Monarchs of the Pacific Coast Hockey League, where he led the league in scoring with 101 points for the 1946 season. A member of the 1974 U.S. Hockey Hall of Fame, please give a warm round of applause for Ray Chason, 2017 Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame. Eddie Jeremiah entered Dartmouth in 1926 after attending high school in Somerville, Massachusetts, and prep school at Hebron Academy in Maine. He earned 9 letters in Somerville in football, hockey, and baseball, while earning 3 more in the same sports while at Hebron. After picking up 2 football, 3 hockey, and 2 baseball letters at Dartmouth, Jeremiah entered the professional hockey ranks as a member of the New Haven hockey team of the Canadian American League. He then split the next season between the New York Americans and the Boston Bruins of the National Hockey League. He also spent the 1933 season with both the Boston Cubs and the New Haven team, again in the Canadian American League. His last year of playing was the 1935 season with Cleveland of the International League. When his playing days were over, Eddie Jeremiah went on to become the coach of the Boston Olympics hockey team and guided them to the National Amateur Athletic Union Championship in 1936. He became varsity hockey coach at Dartmouth a year later and served continuously after that date, except for World War II service, until his retirement in 1967. Dartmouth hockey flourished under Jeremiah's leadership. In 7 of the first 9 years he was at the helm, the Indians won the Pentagonal League Championship and, from 1942 to 46, won a record 46 consecutive games without a defeat. In addition, he led Dartmouth to the NCAA tournament in both 1948 and 1949 and captured Ivy League titles in 1959 and 1960. In these decades as Dartmouth's head coach, Jeremiah directed his teams to 308 victories, 247 losses, and 12 ties. He remained a Big Green coaching legend throughout his entire life. Please welcome to the 2017 Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame class, Eddie Jeremiah. Cliff Thompson graduated from Stoneham High School in 1937, where he lettered in football, hockey, and baseball. He led the team in scoring and was named as the Greater Boston Interscholastic League All-Star for 3 seasons. Cliff spent several seasons with the Boston Olympics and 2 brief tours with the Boston Bruins, a rare feat for an American back then. Cliff took time out of his hockey career to serve in World War II, receiving 2 Bronze Stars, 1 Silver Star, and the French Croix de Guerre. He was inducted into the 1973 U.S. Hockey Hall of Fame and is now part of the 2017 Massachusetts Hockey Hall of Fame class. Please give a warm round of applause for Cliff Thompson.
And to introduce our last one that's going to round out our group, please put your hands together for former Registrar Ron Difilippo.
I've been given the privilege to interview Bernie Michals. I've known him since 1972. My first introduction to
So you sit back and you try to think of what this individual has done. And there are so many things, as you've heard of the people that are inducted, all of the things that they've done that really warrants them to be part of the Hall of Fame. So I have to do something about Bernie Michals. And I says, well, there's got to be something that he's done. Well, let's start off. I kind of McDonald list. I'm not going to give you a 10-minute dissertation on this. He's a father. He's a coach. He's a hockey player. He's an organizer. He's a volunteer. He has a passion for a crazy sport of hockey. And he's a friend. So I'm not going to look at this a friend. So when you have a friend, you've got to have a story. I had the opportunity to entertain foreign people. And one of the ones was the Japanese. And the Japanese love baseball. I said, how the heck does baseball get into hockey? Well, Mr. Michals, he used to have reserve seats on the third baseline of Red Sox. So, you know, smart business guy. I go up to Mr.
Bernie
and says, Bernie, can you help me out? And what would Bernie say? No problem. How many? I says, there's only one guy coming, you know? He says, and what can I say? He loves baseball. There's the tickets. No problem. Well, that's great. As far as Mass Hockey, he is Mass Hockey. He started with the founders, which there are many. And unfortunately, a lot of them are not still around. But he was the one getting the smoke still room, pounding out the rules, doing things as the list went down. So you can read his bio, but that's just a small portion of this individual. So I'm going to leave you the time left here to ask him questions and kind of reminisce of all the things that he's done. But he is
Shawn McEachern, inducted as well tonight. Shawn couldn't be here. He will be here, just not tonight, next year, whatever. But please give him a warm welcome. For your case, yes, I don't know. You guys, kind of
brought you guys up on stage, and you guys didn't really have an opportunity to really say anything. So obviously the first thing is maybe thank you or whatever the first thing that comes to your mind, and we'll kind of pass this to the ground.
Getting very comfortable here in this chair, so make sure I'm awake for this part of the program. I want to thank the Mass Hockey people, Brian, for the nomination. And like all of us, we had a lot of people helping us, and I feel it's appropriate to sit next to Paul, because in the days when public schools could reign, to be part of the Arlington Melrose rivalry was important. I've met some of my high school friends here tonight. But a lot of us, our families were very helpful. I had the benefit of playing for four Hall of Fame coaches between high school and college. Eddie Burns, Cooney Wyland, Tim Taylor, and Billy Cleary. So coaches talk about putting people in places to be successful. I had a lot of help between my family who's here. To play in Arlington where what Eddie Burns did to create something that was important, just as Henry Hughes did in Melrose, that allowed a lot of us to get to a good start. What he created in high school hockey was the first tangible goal was set as a young person in that town. You wanted to play for Edinburgh, you wanted to become. And a lot of the talk here is about family. My brother played, my father-in-law's here played, my father-in-law's brother played for Edinburgh, my father-in-law's brother played for Edinburgh. That's what he created. And so you can't pick where you're born or what time you're born into. But that gave me a start. Didn't know that I would be making a career out of hockey. That's what the start was. And the only other thing before I pass this to Paul, and I remember playing against Paul in summer hockey, is that if it wasn't for a guy named Eddie Walsh deciding to go to private school and not go to Arlington High School, I would have been hopefully like a writer or an actor, or I wouldn't have met my wife, I wouldn't have met half the people in this room. So I was lucky that somebody decided to leave an opening, and I took advantage of it. So thank you everybody for this opportunity.
Good evening. I need a cheat sheet here. I just want to thank Gary Eggleston for putting my name forward. Gary grew up in Melrose like I did. And I'd like to also thank the lecturers and the committee who did the same thing. And I'd like to thank John Tobin, Kevin Kavanaugh, and especially Liz Coyett for helping me so much in these past few weeks. I'd really like to John's not here, but Paul and Bernie, it's a pleasure to be up here with all you guys. A little story about Paul. In around 1956, down at Litterina, they used to have a skating clinic. And it was $2 Saturday morning, around 6 o'clock in the morning. It was a great coach. Skater. When I say horrible, he was horrible. In the Hurley family, we have an expression that goes very applicable to him. You can't make chicken salad out of chicken, you know what. I'm not telling you. But anyway, I'd also like to congratulate the fellows who are lovely and posthumously. I also want to thank Tim Sheedy, Billy Berglund, Bob DiGregorio for supporting me and putting my name forward, and also for Steve Cedarcheck for the fabulous introduction. More importantly, I'd like to thank all of you for being here this evening, supporting Mass Hockey and the Hall of Fame, and all the little kids that you may tell later on about tonight's thing could possibly be sitting up here many years down the line. So with that, thank you.
I actually have a prank in my head. No joke. Can you thank Rob Ray for that? No? Fix that.
I want to thank Liz and Mass Hockey for the opportunity to be here tonight. And I also want to thank Mark Adams for nominating. Without that, I don't think I'd be sitting up here and don't believe Paul. Paul and I went to a lot of hockey schools together growing up. Got in a little bit of trouble on occasion. But I want to thank my family. And Liz, thank you, because every day I'd call you with a new number because they kept coming. And I want to thank my family for being here. Especially my brother and sister, and my whole family, my wife, and I don't know what else to say. I see people, the Kelleher's, who supported me for over the years, afforded me to stop being a police officer, and just great memories, and for Ian Paskowski, he's like one of my kids. And Joe and I go way back. He actually called me one day and said, hey, I got these two goalies coming in from Wisconsin, and could they stay with you? And it happened to be the Rickers. And we bonded, the boys and I bonded. Joe and I kind of ran a co-hockey school together at the beginning. And Joe went to Harvard, and I kind of flunked out of other schools. And I just once again want to thank everybody.
First of all, I want to thank Mass Hockey for bestowing this honor upon me, those who nominated me, and then on the committee who voted for me. Back in 1970 and 71, if we really look at Mass Hockey, which has grown wonderfully since I was there, what is it all about? What are we all about? We're about the people that play, the boys and the girls that play. And when you really think of it, all of us are charged with the awesome responsibility of helping them grow. Not only in hockey, because hockey, we used to say, is a way of life. And from hockey and all athletics, we learn about life. So I'd like to congratulate everybody in this room, and every coach, and every director, for what they do for the youth of our state, especially Mass Hockey, which has grown wilder than my imagination could ever be. Thank you all.
Okay, so, Julie, this is the longest stuff. And so this morning, cramming on the plane, coming in, learning about all the guys, and there's a lot of names, and I started reading your book on the plane. The Hockey Coaching Bible. It got a 4.2 rating out of 5 on Goodreads. Good? Is that good? One of the things that I love about it is the second page, and you dedicated to my first coach professionally, was E.J. McGuire. And just that's one thing that popped. Why E.J., and why that thought, why the dedication?
So E.J. wrote one of the chapters. Between the time that he wrote the chapter and it was published, he passed away. He had a very aggressive disease, and in fact, his name came up this week out in, at the Rules Committee meeting in Indianapolis. I'm on the NCAA Rules Committee. And E.J. used to sit on that, in those meetings as an NHL representative. He was part of Central Scouting, as was Gary Edison is here. And he was just a delightful guy. When you meet a lot of characters in the sport, one of the things I worry about is I deal with Hockey East, everybody's getting more serious. There's less personality in the game. There's a lot of good young coaches who are very good at what they do, but damn, they take it very seriously. They probably paid a lot more than they used to be paid, so they have to. But EJ was one of those guys with a lot of personality. I'd get a letter from him once a year that would, and I'm not making this up, I'd be eager to open the envelope, because he would write in different media. He'd start with pencil, and he'd switch to pen, and then switch to marker. He'd switch from parallel to circular. And it was like a kid at Christmas opening the presents. You wanted to see what was inside the envelope. But like a lot of other people in hockey, he also gave a lot. And when these NHL, Mike Murphy takes his place now for the National Hockey League, and they're just good hockey people. They sit in these meetings. They don't look down their nose at they're the pros or we're the college guys. They want to contribute. Hopefully we do that as college guys to youth hockey in the community. And so he was that special guy, and where we lost him, he wasn't around to see the publication of the book. I thought it was appropriate.
I'll
going to do that just next. I'm looking at the rings here, the hardware. You got the Olympic 68. Talk about that.
Well, as an American boy growing up in this area, the chances of playing professional hockey were kind of slim and none. So it was always my aspiration to, hopefully to play in the Olympics. I was going to be a senior at BC, and after my junior year, I was contacted by the U.S. Olympic team. They asked me if I would come to play the next year, and I said I would be happy to, but there was one problem. Well, what is that? Vietnam was going on, and if you did not have a student deferment, the chances are that you would be in Vietnam. Well, we got around that by getting me an occupational deferment to play in the Olympics. Play in the Olympic Games as a defenseman, and as fate would be, our second line right wing broke his ankle in the second or so game, and as much as I didn't want to play forward, I was put up to forward and did okay, and it was a fabulous experience. I came back the next year, and after I got off the plane from the Olympics, the Bruins were there, and they wanted to sign me. And Milt Schmidt said, we'd like you to come in the office. And I said, I have a problem. And because the Bruins were all Canadian players at that time, they didn't have to deal with Vietnam. So it was said that I better go back to BC. And the following year, I went back to BC and played my senior year at BC.
What's the other one, by the way? Sorry, I don't know how close this is. Is that Hop in here? That's good. What's the other one? It's IHL?
This is from the WHA, first year championship of the Whalers. It was called the AFCO Cup, and each player got one.
You look like Cher. You look good. Next here, Bernie. My career ended at 28 because of an eye injury when I was in the Bruins organization. Can't pass physical anymore, which some of my coaches might think that I put to the puck prior anyways. But I loved it, reading up on you, that you were really big in getting the players to wear visors. Thought on that? Why? Was there an injury history? How did that come about?
We kept getting from parents, coaches, and players, some of them, complaints at USA Hockey. There were a lot of eye cuts, eye loss, teeth out, broken jaws, broken cheekbones. And we were charged with the development of facial protection. In connection with safety in hockey, while I'm here, I'd like to thank Dr. Alan Asher, who took my place as the president of the Hockey Equipment Certification Council, and has done a wonderful, wonderful job since then. It took us working with the American Society of Testing and Materials almost 2 years to develop facial protection, which was then sent to the National Bureau of Standards in Washington. Once there, it almost forces everybody to use them. There were people who didn't think we should have them because they felt that it would make gladiators out of the players, or felt would make the players tougher wearing the mask, not having to worry about their face. The NCAA was grandfathered for 2 years before they had to put them on. To this day, I believe that what we did saved the physical abilities of a lot of players, and they further worked on helmets to make them safer.
Why? You get started, besides parents come to you, anyone in the family, anything, or?
No one in the family was injured. When I played goal, I didn't have a mask. Stupidity, I think you'd call that. that was before Jacques Plante invented the first face mask. But we had a number of complaints with USA Hockey of why don't we do something about facial protection. And that's what we did, put together a great crew. We used to meet once a month in Philadelphia at ASDM. And it took us 2 years to get that mask approved. For any of you who know how ASDM works, it's a work by consensus. One negative vote to the whole membership sends it back to the original committee, and that has to be answered. So it was actually the players, parents, some coaches, they wanted facial protection. We felt charged to give it to them. And to this day, I can't tell you how happy I am we did that.
You have coached everywhere, like everywhere. Prep school, you're up UI College, NCAA, NHL, one with Chicago, a couple of Chicago, one everywhere as well. I coach kids different levels. I coach my four kids. My eldest is 14 and my youngest daughter is 9. And I coach a bunch of that's closer age, but I love the difference. And it's different coaching at different levels because some kids learn, some kids listen, some kids just don't. What age is your favorite to coach? And who was your favorite player you coached?
Can I go in reverse order?
Yeah, yeah. You have the mic. You can do whatever you want.
Teddy knows him. I think he was there with Teddy's brief stint in Providence. A guy by the name of Steve McIntyre.
Hold on. So Teddy isn't on the list then?
No, he wanted to quit. This is the tail end of his career, real quickly. Teddy comes to me in Bridgewater. After the first day of me making him do edge drills, he went, I'm only going to keep clean. This is not for me. And I said, Ted, you can't quit. And he kind of hung around. And by the end of the summer, we always had a hate-love relationship, but by the end of the summer, he stuck it through, and I think he had a pretty good year that year. And I want to thank you for sticking through with me, Teddy. Can I get the PG version of Steve McIntyre? Steve McIntyre was this big, big kid who came from Western Canada, about 30 miles above Edmonton, farm boy, played in the double, was a fighter, came out of the Central League, we needed a tough guy in Providence. So I'm at training camp and Scotty Gordon's the head coach. And I go to Scotty, where the heck did you get him? Because he was not too smooth. And he comes up to the end of the practice and says, Coach, can I speak to you for a minute? I said, sure. And he goes, my dream is to have one game in the NHL. And I got to get the PG version that I said to him. My dream was to date Meg Ryan, and that was never happened. So, I said to Steve, every day you show up, I'll be here at 7:30 waiting for you. And the kid never missed a day. Came, stayed at my home in the summer. Never questioned what I asked him to do. And 225 games later in the NHL, he finished his career as a firefighter now in Charlotte, North Carolina. And I stay in contact with him all the time. As you know, you guys that do the dirty job in the NHL are probably the nicest and the best guys around. That includes you.
That's how you roll up the next question. Yeah.
I enjoy all ages, seriously.
Pick one.
I like to get the 14, 15-year-old kid that thinks he's pretty good and then try to humble him and realize that he's not that good. And then try to, I always believe that you break them down a little, you build them back up, you break them down a little, you build them back up. So, and one other guy I gotta mention right here, a good friend, I coached with Steve at BC, and it was always a pleasure. So, I had fun at BC coaching those guys. I have fun every day when I'm in the NHL coaching those guys. I have fun when I'm on the ice with 9-year-olds. It's what I love. So I guess that's the answer.
I kind of like what you just said, I ain't got an old to the crowd over there, but sometimes you have to learn a little bit about failure. And I'm looking at the sign over there that says, let them play, let them have fun, let them fail. And there's so many things that can be learned from falling, from anything, and then you teach them from there. So I like what you said on that. On that note, one of my favorite things is I just came from an event in Toronto. It was a golf event, but we had a lot of hockey players and a lot of people in rooms like this. We were sitting around and no drinking whatsoever. And one of the things that we always get into is they just had the top 100 list come out of players of our game of all time. You could debate it or whatever, but one of the hardest things to do is, it was a Dale Hawerchuk event. Dale's one of the greatest hockey players. Dale's not on that list. But one of my favorite things to do is when we're sitting around with guys from different eras is who is the best player you've seen or played with or there was. And my dad, Canadiens fan, but sorry, my dad. But he has his favorites, and it's never Bobby Orr. I played with Wayne Gretzky. Obviously, my dad loves Doug Hartman. I played with Wayne Gretzky. He was kind of okay. But, Big Joe Thornton, you can't forget what Joe's done in the last, 15 years of, for what he does passing the puck. There's so many great players in the game today. I see the younger ones. You guys, just by the years you guys were mentioning, some of the stories you guys have said. Give us a name. Who's your favorite? We'll go around the horn.
Well, given it's a Mass Hockey event, I'll stay out of pro hockey and everything. Think about Massachusetts hockey. And I played with some guys that are in the Mass Hockey Hall of Fame. There was one line at Harvard that went in as a line. David Hines, Bob McMahon, and Billy Corkery. We've lost Billy Corkery. And they're called a local line. They were from Arlington, Belmont, Cambridge. And as a goalie at Harvard, watching them in front of me, I was both participant and spectator. And I used to watch local goaltenders from our era, Eddie Walsh, I mentioned earlier, played at Boston University. Cap Rader played at the University of New Hampshire. Neil Higgins, his father, made all the masks. NHL, local masks. His son Neil played at Boston College and played at Norwood High School. And so these are the guys I looked up to as a late convert to goal as a sophomore in high school. And before I pass this along, just one thing I wanted to add about the opportunity again. One of the things that's nice about hockey is you get an event like this. First of all, I get to know my children are on Saturday night, which is not always the case. So having them right in front of me is a bonus. And but everybody knows everybody. So you see the names you go in with. So I remember I became a goalie as a sophomore in high school, and I'd heard about Paul and Shawn Hurley. And I put my name in at the old Green Street rink in Melrose, a hockey town rink. And they called me if they needed a goalie. And I remember one night going in, they said, you're playing against Paul the Shot. And you probably got a feel on me. And that's how I made most of my friends. They said, hey, Joe's a great guy. I got two on him one night. And, so you were one of those guys. I don't know Bernie as well, but I know his sons. And I've worked with them. And you can judge some of their children. And you guys should remember that, by the way. So that speaks volumes to Bernie. And Paul, when I was between jobs years ago, hired me at one of his clinics, and then we worked together. So these connections to hockey go, everybody's got a story. I'm the person next to him, the next table here. And it's kind of nice when we all get together like we are tonight. But my favorites would have been my contemporaries, who were the best at the time I played.
Shooting at you. We made a deal when we played at Little Arena at night that you could play, but you couldn't take a slap shot.
Well, I can see that this guy's really envious. He had the dukes, but not the shot. I'll go to the pro ranks since Joe went with the local collegiate. When I was 16 years old at Melrose High, we had just gone undefeated, played 23 games, and I was telling this to PJ earlier. We played 10-minute periods. One school played a period. You untied your skates, and let's say Melrose was playing Wakefield. The next game would be Belmont against Winchester. They'd play their period, untie their skates. We would tie our skates and go back and play the third time. Then they would make ice. There was no checking from the red line in. So I could skate. I was an offensive defenseman. I just wheeled around and did what I wanted. So I'm 16 years old. There's no amateur draft there. The Bruins, as PJ probably knows, in Canada, the Canadians had exclusive rights of all French Canadians.
Canadians, Bruins own a big area, like 16 back then. They own everything. They own they buy leagues.
So, quick story on John Béliveau. Quick story on John Béliveau, the great Montreal Canadian, and how they got him. He didn't want to play for the Montreal Canadiens. So what they did was the Canadians bought the league. And he owned his rights. And that's what it was back then. That's how teams got to be so dominant. And the Bruins, I think the Bruins have like half of Saskatchewan, Northern Ontario. You just go, I'm going to buy this part of the province. And that's what they kind of did. I do have nicknames, by the way.
So the Bruins vets sent me up to Niagara Falls, and they owned the Niagara Falls Flyers and the Oshawa Generals. And they invited 100 boys, 97 Canadians, and 3 Americans for 6 spots. So the first day of 2 days of skating around, and I'm looking around, and everybody can skate like hell, everybody can shoot. In the afternoon, we're going to have a scrimmage. So the scrimmage starts, and I go behind the net, and I think I'm back in the Middlesex League, and all I know is I'm on the ice looking up. Now the Canadian boys at that time played, I talked to PJ about this, between exhibition games and a playoff, 100 games, and we played 23 games. 10-minute periods, they were playing 20-minute periods. But anyway, there was a little guy on the ice. He had a little whiffle. He was 14 years old, and I just was mesmerized that he could just do what he wanted with the puck. And as PJ said about teams buying a team, the Bruins sent the scout to Parry Sound, Ontario, to scout somebody. And the person that went to scout had a terrible game, but it was this little blonde-headed kid monopolizing. So they bought the team. They had to give the little guy's father a station wagon and aluminize his house. And that is Bobby Orr. And if I was starting a team, he would be my first player, with absolutely no doubt. When he stepped on the ice, he didn't want to give you the puck. You're not going to get it. And I remember a comment by Bobby Hull when he first saw him play. He made a little remark to one of the officials. Why don't we give him his own puck and we'll have our own game? My player would be Bobby Hull.
Every time I'm finishing a story, I pass the mic on. Bernie's over here correcting me. You all, PJ. Shawn Béliveau was with the Quebec Aces, and he's one-upping me on everything. At least it's not on the mic. So now's your chance.
Favorite player? You can see me.
I think in my era it has to be Bobby Orr. And I don't know how many raise your hands have read his book. Because if most coaches coached young men and kids the way he was coached, they'd have a lot more freewheeling and freestyle hockey. His coach let him go and said, if you lose the puck, you lose it, but I want you to do whatever you want to do out there. So don't ever curb the ability to do what you want to do. Don't put a player in a mold. The right wing is going to be doing this and the left wing that. Defenseman that. I certainly didn't with my family, and they're all over there, and I'm very proud of them. And if they could stand up for a second.
Obviously they missed the thing I did before, but when you stand up, they probably did. Stand up so we can clap for you guys. He's proud of you guys. Stand up.
this family has five goalies in it, a forward, and then one granddaughter is a very good basketball player. She's the only smart one in the bunch. They give you the will to keep going, all of you with your families. But when I said before, we are charged with the awesome responsibility of helping from young boys to men grow into life. And that's what coaching is all about. And I think these three gentlemen here epitomize coaching and what they've given back to the game. And they deserve a round of applause too. The game continues to progress. It's faster, it's quicker, it's rougher. And my only concern is the size of the players and the speed of the players, while the rink can't be made any bigger. And that's caused a lot of head injuries, which are not intentional. They just happen. Size of rink, size of player, and speed. And the bigger players, after a while, you get so much size out there, you really have nowhere to go. And this is a problem, because you can't rebuild every rink in the National Hockey League. Thank you.
Coach, Coach had the chance of playing, you coached some unbelievable players over time and helped players as well. Adam Oates came up before, you mentioned Patrick Kane. Favorite or most talented, whichever one awed you the most?
I want to say, I didn't mention Jonathan Taves. Jonathan, at 21 years old, was the captain of our team in Chicago. And if he knew that it meant I was working with somebody that really didn't want to stay on the ice after practice, he'd say, Mr. V, I'll stay on, let's do something. And he's a pure leader. And they won 3 Stanley Cups under him in 3 different periods. He's probably one of my favorites. And then I have a closeness to Adam Oates. We're friends. And he made Brett Hull, Cam Neely, 100-point men. And I'm trying to think who was in Washington.
Bondra.
He had 3 guys that he centered that had 100 points or more in his career. And he was not only a brilliant hockey player, but he also, I think, still holds records in Ontario for box lacrosse. So I've been really blessed with a lot of great players and been fortunate enough that they kind of like me for some reason. I have a hard time understanding that. And I would have to say Jonathan Taves, because he's a leader. That'd be my number one.
Okay, I don't know if you guys all got this book in front of you. I'm gonna give a little plug right now.
Just because this kind of sums up the night a little, there's a Mass license plates that you guys could, purchase them. Is that how this works? You purchase them, and all the money that gets raised from these license plates goes to grants and helping grow the game. And time, energy, and a lot of things you guys do help. So there's a little bit of money. And you guys can make it whatever you want. I mean, if you want to put my shot, big dog, shot, if you want to put my name on the back of your license plate, I'll let you do that. I'm going to give you this. We'll wrap it up with, if you could put something on the license plate, what would you put on your license plate? How about that? No, you can put as many letters on there as you want. What would you put on your license plate? It's PJ. There's don't put the dots in
there.
D-O-C-K.
D-O-C-K.
That was easy. Yeah? Okay, good. All right, well, you know what? Go on that then, Coach.
I can't answer the question, but I'll tell you the best license plate I've seen recently.
must have been in Maine, because, you know, they have the graphics on the left, so there was a moose. And the rest of the license plate said N-S-Q-U-R-L. And it's in front of me. Moose. Moose and squirrel. And if you ever
watch Rocky and Bullwinkle, Doris Badenov always referred to moose and squirrel. So,
this guy knew he could get the vanity plate with the moose on the left, and he asked for and squirrel.
You're not going to top that. Actually, we're not, let's end, I'm not being talked. So I'm going to get down. You guys stand up. Ladies and gentlemen, give these guys an round of applause.
Do it for your name, 'cause there's gonna be a day when you're